Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc. I'm joined today by Andy Winter, the Chief Executive of Brighton Housing Trust, or increasingly BHT. You're serving an area that extends quite a way beyond your Brighton roots now, if I could
Brighton
put it
like East, Bourne and Hastings, and we do a lot more than just housing.
And you still have quite a presence in Brighton. What do you do beyond housing?
We do a whole range of activities looking to support people who are excluded, people living in poverty, people who need to be supported about their rights, addressing mental health problems and addressing addictions, amongst other things, including employment, training, a whole range of activities.
So helping people who are unemployed back into the world
Absolutely,
of work, that
yeah.
kind of thing. Last week you celebrated 30 years with BHT, and if I say celebrated, did you do anything special to mark the occasion? I mean, apart from sort of taking to the airwaves and penning some more words.
I took a very small group of people out for lunch who've supported me over the years, people who've been on our board in the past, and one or two of my current colleagues, and my wife and daughter as well came. So it was just a very understated occasion. My colleagues did make a bit of a fuss, which was very, very generous of them, and they got cards signed from people across the organisation, and it was very moving. I was very touched by the generosity.
That was lovely to hear. And I mean, you've risen up the ranks, haven't you? I mean, what was your first job at BHT?
I started just a stone's throw from where we're sitting today, working as a hostel worker in a hostel for all comers, and gradually then moved into doing work around mental health and then addictions. I became the senior manager for mental health and substance misuse services. And then
I was just about to say you got into drugs after that, didn't you?
In a manner of speaking, yes. And then I became chief executive in 2003.
So 12 years in the top job, and as I say, you started, we're just off the old steam here, so you haven't gone far, but you have. what's been the biggest change since you joined BHT?
The biggest change in society, I think, are the numbers of people who are being excluded and the sorts of people who never in 100 years thought they would ever need the service of an organisation like Brighton Housing Trust. We have people who have been in paid jobs, in relationships, the relationship breaks down, they think they can just move in to a one-bedroom flat on their own. And then they discover that the average one-bedroom flat in Brighton is now £850 a month.
Yeah.
If you're on benefits, that they will only pay up to £612 a month. So the situation has reached a critical crisis point. Property prices in Brighton are astronomical. You need to be earning close to £100,000 to be able to afford to buy a property in Brighton now, which means that so many people, our sons, our daughters, people who've been brought up here, don't have any hope of ever getting onto the property ladder.
I mean, talking about the property ladder, I mean, one of the other big changes that's happened since you joined BHT is the way people buy properties now. I mean, we used to buy a home. Mm. Brighton is, yeah, I think, becoming...
Properties used to, houses used to be where people lived. Now they've become an investment opportunity. I think one of the other changes for the worse is what's happened to my own sector, housing associations, who are now building homes for people who we were never set up to accommodate. There's a development here at Brighton Station that's just been sold for £850,000.
Wow.
By a housing association. And now I know the justification will be we recycle the profits so that we can build homes for the poor. Sadly, there are only 15 houses for people on low incomes, for low affordable rents being planned in Brighton over the next 4 years. And that's a scandal.
And when we say affordable rents, I mean, I want to put quote marks around that, because...
Now, the government refer to affordable as 80% of the market. I believe in a living rent, which is around 35% of people's disposable income. That's what most people would pay. Most people living in rented accommodation in Brighton now are paying over 49%, a little over 49% of their disposable income in rent.
And will the government let a bank lend to you at sort of that amount, that percentage of your income?
No.
So they're applying one standard for people who want to buy a house through a mortgage and protect them, if you like, from overborrowing, but allowing poorer people to be overburdened. Is that the sort of criticism that people make?
People just cannot get the mortgages. People cannot get afford the deposits required. So this great concept of a property owning democracy, there are far fewer people owning their own homes today than there were 5 years ago. So, in fact, housing is becoming a narrower and narrower commodity for people, and they're seeing it as a commodity. They're seeing it as an investment opportunity rather than a place to live.
I think we're seeing in the Sunday supplements Brighton properties being advertised as yeah. investment opportunities. I mean, even when the King Alfred proposal was being sort of aired, even seven years ago, it was advertised in, I think, the Telegraph and the Standard as yeah. an investment opportunity.
And exactly, and that's one of the problems. We have such a major housing crisis in Brighton. The people who can afford are often the people who don't live here already, the DFLs, the down from Londons, creating a new group of people, yes. The AFBs, the across from Brighton, the people who have been born and brought up in Brighton, who now are moving to New Haven and St Leonard's or Hastings, yeah. where the property prices are a little bit more affordable. But even they are beginning
They're
to see...
They're not cheap, though, either.
No.
And I mean, beginning to, it sounds being a bit glib, it almost sounds like a good justification for the Northern Powerhouse. And, there is talk at Brighton Council last week, you may have heard, that they're looking further afield when they house people mm-hmm. who need temporary accommodation now. So before, they have been putting people outside Brighton and Hove, but not terribly far, and now they're looking a bit further yeah. afield. They're still reluctant to go too far, yeah. but...
I think local authorities are in a no-win situation. They've been the whipping boys for the last few years, and they are being asked to do things that have statutory duties where they're not resourced to do it. So
on the one hand, the government's saying, you must do this. On the other hand, it's saying, but we're not going to give you the money to
exactly.
do it.
Exactly, and there isn't the accommodation locally, given the way the housing market works, for the local authority to have houses in order to accommodate families who are in priority need.
Well, I mean, have the numbers changed much? Because you were saying earlier that the kind of people who might come to an organisation mm-hmm. like BHT for help now mm-hmm. are people who never would have imagined yeah. they might need your help.
Housing waiting lists are longer than they've ever been, but also the most visible manifestation of homelessness, rough sleeping,
yes.
the numbers there are right up.
We're coming to the end of the summer, though. I mean, surely that's the time of year when it's a bit easier, a bit less uncomfortable, if you can put it that way.
Well, that used to be the case, but because of concerted action on behalf of many organisations over the last few years, we haven't seen that seasonal spike this year. Every year we've seen, over the summer months, people coming to Brighton.
Yes.
But, for example, at our day centre, First Base, we've been telling people for the last couple of years, you can't just come and stay in Brighton for 6 weeks. If you're here, you have to engage. We will help you move back from whence you came.
Yes.
And people realise that they're not going to get a free ride when they come here. So we haven't seen that seasonal spike
yeah.
that we've seen in previous years. So I'm not expecting to see
a huge drop-off
reduction,
either.
No.
What sort of numbers are we looking at the moment?
We're looking at about 160 people each night are sleeping on the streets of Brighton.
And are they left out on the streets, or are they sort of, is there somewhere they can... I mean, I know in the winter, for example, about a dozen local churches sort of take turns accommodating people overnight. And, you know, small numbers, but it helps...
Yeah, and we open an emergency weather shelters over the coldest months where we accommodate between 50 and 70 people a night so that they're not out on the street. The churches play their part of 15 to 20 people, but Brighton Housing Trust and the other homelessness organisations, the City Council, all rally together to find, and we run it from three different locations so that there isn't a concentration in any one neighbourhood.
And, I mean, is it the same sort of people who are needing, you know, help increasingly now? So the you're saying the people who if you like a sort of relatively low incomes mm-hmm. but in work, for mm-hmm. example, who, and people who've had their relationship breakups. I mean, when did we start seeing that shift?
Probably over the last 5 years, but it's increased over the last two. An interesting figure from the government itself is that 92% of all people making claims for assistance with their housing costs are people in low-paid employment.
So the government's basically subsidising the private rented sector?
I would say they are subsidising low pay, because people are on very, very low pay, cannot afford their housing yeah. costs, become eligible for housing benefit. So something like a proper national minimum wage or a living wage would actually save the taxpayer a lot of money.
I mean, is this part of the reason, do you think, why the government's shifted slightly since the general election into that kind of area, pushing, sort of trying to sort of, you know, we've had years and years of hearing politicians say we need wage restraint of all stripes, mm-hmm. and now we're hearing politicians saying, well, actually, in the private sector, we need to pay people a bit more.
I think that's one reason. I'm not sure whether the proposal that was announced in the emergency budget or the summer budget actually is a true national, a true living wage. It's actually lower than the current living wage.
Is it? So it's a step in the right direction for where we are, but it's not where we would need to be. Okay, well, I'd like to come on. I know something that you have written about and talked about is the right to buy, and perhaps we could come on to that after the break in a few minutes. And is this something that's going to affect you and your organisation?
It could, but not in any significant way, but it's something I feel very, very strongly about.
Well, I'll come back to that in just a second, so please don't go away. And join us again in just a few moments after these ads. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank Leduc, and Andy Winter from Brighton Housing Trust, or BHT. Andy, thanks for joining us. I sensed even before the break that I could see a blood pressure rising when I mentioned the right to buy. It's a policy that divides people. I mean, there are a lot of people who, I mean, it probably won or was a key factor in winning the 1979 election for Margaret Thatcher and the Conservatives. Hugely popular with what was called the aspirant working class. Lifting some of the estates where people were actually able to do up their own homes without waiting for a workman to come sometime 28 days later or longer just to change a light bulb, this kind of thing. So hugely empowering on the
Absolutely,
one hand.
Yeah.
But it has, I guess, like a lot of things, it has the law of unintended consequences has meant it's a contributory factor to where we are now?
Well, I think it's often seen as a panacea for people who are trying to do something about the housing crisis. In fact, it does nothing to do to help resolve the housing crisis. It just means that certain housing is moved from social rents into the private rented sector. 40% of all homes, council houses sold through right to buy are now in the private rented sector, charging rents of three or four times what the former social rents were. So it's actually exacerbating the housing crisis, not helping it.
But are we not now building houses? I mean, one of the big criticisms early on was that millions of houses were sold from council housing stocks, and they just weren't replaced by new council houses, so that waiting lists grew. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've got about 20,000, possibly more than 20,000 people on the waiting list in Brighton and Hove.
And those are only the people who qualify to join the waiting list. A lot of people don't.
So there are a lot of people who'd like to have a place to rent, but
absolutely
don't meet the sort of the increasingly strict criteria.
Yeah.
But the government's now said, well, when a council sells a house, it builds one in its place. Is that happening?
It's not happening. If that was happening, it would
ameliorate the problem,
I guess. A bit, yes, but it wouldn't actually be creating all the additional homes we do need. What's happening, depending on which statistics you want to rely on, either...
Lies, damn lies and statistics. Any of them, I'm a journalist.
Either 14 homes sold with one replacement, or 19 homes sold with one replacement, but depending on the statistics you want to follow.
Either way, not a great ratio.
It's not the one-for-one replacement. And rather than extending right to buy to housing associations...
Which is what's planned.
It's being proposed, yes, and probably will happen. They should actually sort out the current policy to make sure that there is that one-for-one replacement.
I mean, there's a sort of, I guess, the sort of government's belief, and I don't think the previous Labour government was vastly different in the sort of in the belief that the market would build to meet demand, so they would create supply to meet demand. What seems to be happening is a lot of land banking, and then drip feeding houses onto the market to keep the prices running up, a bit like the way OPEC operates with its oil cartel.
Something like that. And there's also something called build to invest, where people are building developments and then just leaving them empty because they know property prices are increasing by 10%, and after 5 years there's a 50% increase in the return that they can get on those properties. There were 8 townhouses built in a town along the south coast in Sussex that have been left empty for over 2 years now. 8 four-bedroom townhouses.
Well, their value appreciates.
Absolutely. And that is a scandal. And the government... I've been calling that Brighton should be declared a housing crisis zone because the situation here is so extreme, that we need to do something extraordinary if we're even going to begin to stop the crisis getting worse. And by doing that, I would say all public land should be used 100% for homes for rent at social rents. I think any private development should have 50% of all homes developed for social rent. That way we might just begin to see the supply increase of the homes we need. We don't need to give away precious land so that you can have people building for sale, second homes, people moving down from London. That's the last thing
we
need.
I mean, it's inevitable in a place like Brighton, we're going to have second homes, surely. It says it's a resort. It's not the last resort. It's a wonderful place.
It's a wonderful place,
and people want to, you know, people who can't spend all their time here because they have to work elsewhere do want to be able to enjoy
indeed
what we have.
Yeah.
You know, even locally, councils of all stripes, when the Conservatives were in administration, the Greens and now Labour have all sort of promised to build. I mean, you know, we probably have one of the only Conservative councils in the country that was actively pushing council house building.
Yeah.
I think they came across just how many obstacles there are in the way for a willing council to do that kind of work. And I think the Greens found the same thing, and Labour are trying to learn the lessons now from that.
And I think one of the things we should be really grateful for in Brighton, Brighton is a political hothouse, and there's so many divisions, but actually what we've been really, really lucky to have is successive administrations who are genuinely concerned. And these are parties of all different persuasions, people who are really concerned about housing, about homelessness, and trying to get the right solution. And even though there's a lot of bluster and posturing, in fact, there's a lot of
common ground
and common sense coming from politicians of all parties.
It's very unfashionable to say this, you know. I mean, absolutely, it's interesting that, you know, you do hear the sort of like the posturing in some of the debates, quite often a common sort of a common sort of goal, as it were, even if they sometimes disagree about the means to get there. Mm-hmm. There is a sort of all-party drive forward
to
try and get homes built.
We're very lucky in Brighton.
But there are huge obstacles in the way. I mean, you were talking earlier about housing associations, and yet the rules that enable them to build on a decent scale have been altered so that actually it's not, you know, it's not financially sensible for them to do that if they're to remain sustainable organisations looking after, for example, their existing tenants. You know,
well, debatable for the larger ones. I'm not convinced by the arguments of the larger housing associations who are reluctant to build homes for rent. They see it far more profitable to develop homes for outright sale and shared ownership. That will meet some need, but it's not actually going to in any way address the real housing crisis that we're facing.
I mean, some things, in 30 years, I'm guessing some things have changed for the better.
I think the cooperation between organisations is much, much better than it has ever been before.
Locally or sort of
locally,
wide, further
locally
afield?
I think I'm just talking about Brighton and Hove now. That has definitely improved, and we see each other less as competitors and more as partners. And because of that, as I said earlier on, we've seen the increase in rough sleeping not increasing as much as it would have otherwise.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. I mean, are you able to sort of get a feel for how that compares with, for example, Eastbourne and Hastings, where you also have sort of staff and operations?
It's very difficult to compare one locality with another. The climate is very different. The political situation is very different. The infrastructure is very different. What we can do in Brighton, we couldn't possibly do just plant in Eastbourne because there isn't the infrastructure. We have tried that with one particular initiative, and it didn't work. It went horribly, horribly wrong, let's face it. So not everything over 30 years has been perfect.
What does success look like for BHT and for the individuals you help, for example?
For BHT, well, for the individuals, that's quite clear that we can help change lives. We can address the causes of their poverty, of their homelessness, of their addictions, of their mental health, and that they can gain more independence. We can empower them. And what's a great pleasure for me, the greatest pleasure I have, is walking down London Road on a Saturday morning and bumping into half a dozen people whose lives have changed as a result of what they've done by being involved with BHT. And some people go back. I got into a taxi at Palmyra Square not long ago, and the taxi driver had been through our addiction services about 20 years ago.
Wow.
And that was just so rewarding. That's what I love about my job. I think it's the best job in Sussex, because lives are changed. What does success look for BHT? Well, I think we and all other organisations have failed. The fact that we're still here is a sign that we haven't been successful. And the day that we make ourselves redundant because our services are no longer needed, then we can, at that moment, we can say, job well done, but we're a long, long way away from that.
Well, I was going to say any regrets, but I'm going to be slightly facetious now and say, talking of regrets, can I just take you to the rugby for a moment? We hosted some great matches in Brighton the weekend before last, one of which, you're from South Africa originally, your team were hot favourites to just walk all over Japan.
It was meant to be one of the highlights of my sporting life. The World Cup in Brighton, at the Amex.
South Africa playing.
And I got tickets four rows from the front. We were 500-1 on to win that match. What could possibly go wrong?
You're glad you're not a betting man.
And the biggest shock in international rugby history.
But an amazing contrast as well between, if you like, I mean, we've relatively well behaved at the Amex, even on football days, but I mean...
Oh, it was wonderful. We were sitting alongside a Japanese family, and we were talking to them beforehand, and we shook hands and posed for photographs together. Afterwards, we congratulated them, and the atmosphere was amazing. I was distraught, but I couldn't possibly help just reflect that I was at one of the greatest sporting moments, and fair play to Japan. But the thing I love most of all is what happened at Victoria Station later on that evening, when one of the trains from Brighton came full of Japanese supporters and South African supporters. You'd never get this in football.
No, no.
But travelling up together, and when the train arrived at Victoria, the South African fans formed a guard of honour and applauded the Japanese supporters off the train and allowed them to go through the barriers first.
And
now, rugby is a class sport.
Please watch again soon.